systems, mostly security and privacy issues. That's what I like to study. And here, I'm here, and I wanted to get you excited about this interesting field about credit networks, and that's why we have this tutorial. All right. So in the morning, we saw in Ross's talk that indeed we are seeing in last maybe from 2000 to 2010, we saw a shift where all our global marketplaces, our global hotel systems, our global taxi systems are slowly started to get replaced with things which are much global in the sense of Uber, Airbnb, Snapchat, Amazon, eBay. So we most of the stuff that we use today, we try to buy them from these global systems rather than your local retailer. What we can see here is that, however, most of these systems are still centralized. And maybe in last few years or something like that, we started to see a move towards a decentralizing such a system. So having something which is global, but still decentralized. It happened in terms of initially in Bitcoin form, but then it has started to grow in various different themes, mostly in the currency systems, like where different kind of currency started to get developed. And although it's still only restricted to payments in most case, but people have already started to envision the applications of that outside the payments and even all sort of different systems such as supply chain or emailing systems, or you name it. So to find that the diamonds are getting transferred correctly across the system, or the meat that I'm eating is actually a proper meat, it's not a horse meat. Things that people see that there are various applications where such technology can be employed. And we can say that we want to basically, it's kind of a overestimation, but some companies even try to use blockchain for everything. Okay, so although it may not be applicable to everything, but indeed one can see that although the cryptocurrencies may or may not survive, Bitcoin may or may not survive, Ethereum can also a similar thing. However, the concept of distributed ledgers, or as it's called as blockchains today, is here to stay. And there are various interesting applications that people are developing in the organizational setting as well as in a global setting. And we are going to see many interesting applications coming in the future. So this slightly old chart just shows that it's not only that the general public is interested in that, but the company is also getting interested in such technology. It's outdated for all practical purposes. I mean, maybe these numbers will just shoot even further, but I just couldn't find any better chart showing these time numbers. There are also many startups which are coming in this space, and there are just a lot. They are trying to build on some, first develop some really base technologies, and also try to build something on top of that where they plan to apply that in very interesting scenarios and places. And today we are going to focus on something which is in this big map, which I guess most of you, at least on that part, can see down there. It's the credit networks or Ripple Stellar, which comes with a box called Special, and it's a base technology or infrastructure technology, and we are going to study these credit networks in more details today. So before we start the discussion, the aim of this task is to make you think more about the interesting questions that you can solve in this setting, rather than just giving you answer that, yeah, this can be done in this way, because there are several challenges here. So I'll be very happy if you leave this room with more questions, but more interesting questions than just some mere basic answers, okay? In that sense, if you have any question anytime, it's a small room, and I assume most of us have a good voice, so you can just stand up and ask or just raise your hand. I'll be more than happy to just give the answer immediately if it is possible, okay? All right, so what are credit networks? Let's start with something basic. So assume that, consider a transaction that can happen in real world. We are going to assume our Alice and Bob's. And let's say Bob provided some service which cost $100 to Alice. And Alice, in this example, does not have immediate way to pay Bob back, okay? But like with most of the system, it can happen that Alice can create or provide a statement saying that, okay, I owe you $100, okay? And the idea is that maybe this statement can be later used by Bob to actually get money from Alice, or as you can see later, maybe from somebody else, Okay, so the idea is that this IOU currency, IOU kind of a network, you can form the whole network, and Bob may have capability to get back the money afterwards. How? We can see just very soon. Let me add, in the credit network representation, basically this statement will get formed into such a link between Bob and Alice, which just shows that $100 going from Alice to Bob, because that's an IOU link. Okay? Now, let's say they went on a hike, and they took Carol and Dave with them together. And that hike, they decide to, they are in Europe, so they went on hike there. And there, Dave paid something for Carol. Okay? And that was in Euro, and Dave and Carol, they, again, Carol is not able to immediately pay back Dave, okay? Now, the idea is that Carol wants to owe Dave, let's say, this 10 euros. But the challenge for them is that they say that, look, we are not going to see each other anymore further, okay? So how can we settle this system so that we can still manage this, this transaction among ourselves, but at the same time get the... At the same time, don't have a debt which can never get paid. So they know that, look, Carol will say that I know Alice, and Dave will say that he knows Bob. And they say that, let's say we settle them through Alice and Bob, which are typically are more conversant with each other, and they will eventually have capability to settle their transactions. Okay? For simplicity, I'm going to assume that the dollar is equal to euro, but let's see. Okay, so what they can do instead is that now this one link can get transferred to a whole chain where Carol settle this payment with the Dave by this these links which goes through Alice and Bob. As you saw, the difference here that that link between Alice and Bob got changed from 100 to 110. Okay, but the key thing to remember here is that if you take Alice or Bob, their inflow and outflow still remains the same. From Alice to Bob, it was 100 previously. Even now, it is 100, which is basically 110 minus 10. So in principle, Alice and Bob allowed this transaction, but they did not lose anything in the process. Okay? So the credit network or settlement network is just such a system. And the idea, typically, when we try to perform any kind of a payment, you try to find out the seller and the buyer in such a network. Okay? Let's say we are going to perform a transaction between Bob and Carol. And let's say Bob needs to pay Carol $15. Okay, so the idea in such a system will be they'll try to find out a path or maybe a series of path. Or maybe we can just say they can try to run a max flow algorithm and try to find out a path going from Bob to Carol, and then they will check if that path has enough value to perform this transaction. As it turns out, in this case, they have such a path. Okay, and then the idea will be they'll take this path and they'll try to perform this or settle this transaction over this path. And as you can see, the links respectively got reduced to settle this transaction. Okay? So the idea will be always whenever you can settle a transaction, you settle it via the current network. If you can't, then depending upon whether both the participants of the transaction or settlement parties applicable, then you add a new link to the system. Okay? So that's the basic concept of credit network, that everything you want to settle, you can settle that over the path. So, and this is the final network then. Now, what can be key questions in such a network, okay? So the first thing that I like to mention here is that this is not something new whatsoever. I mean, you can relate that to your daily experience, and indeed, the root for such a system can be found in like old barter system, or maybe slightly notoriously known system called Hawala. You might have heard this name in the context of the old systems which were employed to actually transfer the money across the boundaries. Okay, but we are going to now obviously make it at much bigger level, and the aim is to make such a large network. Okay, so the first problem that you need to find out is path selection, right? I mean, A, how you find out the path from our the sender to the receiver for the transaction. And the second thing is that how once you select, if you have multiple choices available, how you make the choices. Okay, so the first problem is actually a max flow problem. But we know that the max flow is a good, it's not like a NP hard problem or whatsoever, but it still may not scale really better for as the number of nodes and number of edges in the system grow, okay? But we'll consider that question slightly later. The another thing is that how we select the path. And there are different, one can define that in different way. You want to perform as many transactions as possible, okay, in such a system. And that problem is studied in the economics literature or in that field, in more like a term like social welfare problem, that you want to allow as many transactions as that can happen there. Okay, or maybe you want to allow the transaction with the largest volume in your current system, given an input graph and a given set of transactions, you want to allow as large system as possible the number of transactions or volume. You can define the social welfare problem in a different way. And as it turns out, it's in most scenarios, it's an NP-hard problem. But for our discussion, we are just going to not too much worry about this, the whole system regarding NP-hardness or whatsoever. We'll stick our discussion to that we are fine as long as we can perform the transactions. But I mean, the path selection is also an interesting problem. But for us, we'll just choose whichever path we can find for our discussion today. The next thing that is important in such a system is that how you define that this network is useful. And the key challenge there, or the key term there, is the liquidity of the network. What I mean by liquidity, I can try to define that with an example, like how can we try to measure it. So I'll pick two random nodes in system, and I'm going to pick a random transaction value in such a system within some particular range. And I'll try to perform this transaction. And my liquidity will be the more liquid the network is, that means I should be able to perform this transaction with higher probability. In the ideal case, I want to allow transaction between any two party at any given point of time. Okay, so we can form just a whole clique where everybody have link with everybody else, and we can try to perform the transaction. However, I assume that some of you must have already tried to think that maybe the real world can't work there. Indeed, even when we make friends on our social network, we just don't friend with everybody. We select people wisely, and only our friends in the real world is the one who we try to connect to. And it has advantages. Okay? So the opposing property in that respect is the Sybil tolerance, as we call. And the property by Sybil tolerance, we mean that the first question that we can try to ask is that how many Sybil nodes can we allow in such a system? And I'm going to say here and explain that in the latter side that maybe here we are not going to worry about the number of the nodes or number of the bad nodes. But instead, what we'll worry about is that how much IOU credit that Sybil systems or the malicious node can withdraw from the honest parties or the well-behaved parties. And that's what we'll worry about. And how can adversary distribute that among his nodes, and what kind of topology that he can allow here. Okay, so the challenge in this system, as it should become clear soon, will be to play with this liquidity and the Sybil tolerance properties. Okay, that how much bad links you can allow in the system so that the system still remains liquid enough. So as you can see here, just to make it clear, one thing we can characterize this whole system as we are no longer doing transition between two parties. We actually employ a whole path. So it can be looked at as a pairwise credit allocation, and it's a trust which is distributed. So not only I trust my immediate neighbors, but I, in the process, may also have to trust their friends or friends and so on, okay, until I perform and finish my transactions. And as it turns out, in this case, the misbehaving party may try to either disallow transactions, or maybe they perform the transaction halfway through, and then when the links are changed or whatever, they say that, no, I didn't receive what I should have received. Okay? So in that sense, they may try to introduce some inconsistencies in the network. But as we are going to see, the idea will be this will be bounded with a particular number, and sometimes it can be also localized based on how you define your credit network. What I mean by that is, let's take this example here in our system, and we assume that this person Eve in between is somebody who may try to actually cheat in some way or other. They may also try to do double spending, or they may try to actually deny the transaction or whatever. And I'm going to claim here that the links that matter the most in terms of amount of badness that they can introduce into the system are the amount of IOUs or amount of trust that they can get from the other nodes in the system. For example, here, the links that matter is a link from Bob to Eve and a link from Alice to Eve, okay? In many systems, you may allow those nodes to just trust me. I mean, it may be possible that, for example, in Twitter, anybody can follow me, and I won't be able to even remove them from such a system. Okay, so in most scenario, the links that they create or the trust that they introduce to the other systems may not affect significantly. What matters is how much they can get, how much trust they can garner from the rest of the system. Okay, now moving on, why I mentioned that the number of civil nodes does not matter, but instead how much trust that they owe matter, that's what I'll try to show here. So the idea will be, let's say we have on the left-hand side, we have these well-behaved nodes. They will agree to the transaction the way it should be performed in a credit network. And right-hand side, we try to introduce some malicious or civil nodes. In principle, we can assume that there can be, the civil nodes may try to just make a whole network, a very good click among themselves, okay? We do not want to have a well-defined or precise identity, like with most of our networks, we want to allow pseudonymity. We also want any number of identities to come in picture. Okay, so in principle, all these things can happen. But then idea will be the amount of badness that they can do is exactly related to the red links that I'm showing there. That is the trust that they or the IOU currencies that they can extract from the other part of the network. Okay. And basically, we can just define maybe something like edge cut, and that edge cut between the well-behaved world and the civil node is one which decide whether something bad can happen or how much weirdness can happen in the system. And the idea there is that we can just see in such a system why this can be a useful concept is that introducing such nodes is a much easier problem than extracting actually the trust from the well-behaved nodes. So it's similar in our standard social network. For example, they can create any number of links, any number of identities, but to make people friends, to make friends with the well-behaved or the correct user is always a challenge for the adversary. And that's why most of the social network, especially like something like Twitter, can survive. So now what we are going to do is that using this concept, maybe can we try to see if it can be employed in different scenarios where indeed we talk about such identities which are well dispersed and they want to actually communicate with each other in different form. As it turns out, not exactly the same term as credit network, but such systems have been studied for different applications. For example, there was a system in 2008 at NSTI where they tried to use such links and the communication over the path to allow the emails for flow from the sender to the receiver. And then the idea there was everybody get a particular limit for the day, and you can send email to anybody else as long as you have enough credit go from you to this particular person. Okay, and the hope was that with this we can stop spam because you can only perform, you can only allow spam communication up to a particular limit. And then you have to stop because you just do not have enough credit present in your system. There is also another example that we are going to see more later is that maybe you can also build such a network based on the in the e-commerce system like eBay so that you can know which are the better users to communicate and perform the transaction with and which are not. Okay, there is also another work where they try to actually decide in a system where you do not have a well-defined identity how to allow voting. And there they try to use civil-resistant voting using the similar concept where you can allow your vote will have value which will be equal to the amount of trust or amount of IOUs or amount of credit that flows from you to the guy who is voting. Okay, so there are examples that worked out and many more things that can happen. And when we talk about the payment, there is indeed already a network called Ripple, which is a real-life credit network, where they exactly try to perform transactions where the users can settle their debts and their transactions through such communication system. Okay, for most of our talk, we're going to focus Ripple as our key example. But let me still show you the advantage of that by giving one slide on the bazaar. Okay, so here I'm just giving a very, very high level overview. I mean, if you have a question, the one of the authors is just sitting at the back over there. And so in this particular system, let's say we are not going to assume the directed link. For simplicity, we are going to assume that the links are undirected. It's like Facebook, where when you make friends, the friendship is mutual. Okay? And similarly, you are going to have such a trust links between all these players. And when, let's say we want to perform a particular transaction, the idea will be, let's say a transaction happened between the our Alice and Dave, which is on the right-hand side, and the transaction was for the value $10, okay? What they will do is that they initially try to find out, is there a path for this value? And they'll try to perform this transaction. And if it is possible, the values will be reduced on path as the transaction gets executed and the values get settled. And then two things can happen. Let's say there was a positive review that the seller and the buyer here, we are considering system like eBay, and they both were happy with this transaction. That means they say that this was a good effect and it introduced a good effect to the system. Then value will increase by 10, and there is a direct link which will get formed in between Alice and Bob. Okay, the example that we saw earlier, that didn't happen. And I mean, one can define credit network the way you want to and define the rules. And the idea will be define your network and try to study the liquidity and CIBIL tolerance in any such scenario. And here, we are considering undirected links, and the links also grow much faster. Okay? And to stop the wrong effects, what they introduce otherwise is that if there's a negative review from both the senders or receiver, and several times, you, like with the standard fairness problem, we cannot determine who is there behind anything wrong. And then idea will be, we'll just stick to the network as it got changed. Okay? So any of them, let's say our Alice or Dave, they are malicious. As you can see here, the amount of badness that they can perform will be equal to amount this. Let's say Alice is malicious here. So the things that she can maybe actually don't get the good but do not pay for that, that can be restricted by something like here 25, because that's the links that she gets with the all other players. Okay? So that's just an example that I'd like to take. Now, coming back to the setting that we're looking here was the Ripple protocol. So Ripple will be a network, and the idea will be there you want to perform transactions. So you will assume that the users are connected to their banks in such systems where they form links with their banks, and there are already banks in US and in Germany and also growing in Canada and all other countries. And as you can see there, the users form links with them, and they get the values on their links from those banks in the form of either loans or the money that they put in their bank, and then respectively obtain that credit. Okay? It's also possible that in this system, or the key advantage in key application that is emerging such a system is that you need not to restrict it with just one currency, right? Okay? If somebody allows taking dollars on one link and replacing them with Bitcoin or replacing that with the euros on other link, it's possible that you can perform inter-currency transactions. Okay? And indeed, the remittance is coming out to be a key application. As you can see, I mean, here, people are, there can be different currencies on different networks, and you can basically allow the inter-currency transmission. Okay? And they claim that indeed they show the differences in terms of the how the transaction values and what are the possibilities here. And as compared to the bank, current banking system, especially given that the number of the fee can be very small, like with the standard blockchain kind of systems, and so can be the speed can be very high, that this can be a really good technology to perform transaction across the globe in much simpler time. So indeed, as it turns out, the Ripple is significant, can significantly improve the cross-currency remittance and the settlement, and that certainly is a use case that is emerging in this particular space. Okay, but you may ask here, and maybe it's clear to some, but it's certainly an important question to ask that. So what, I mean, we already have Bitcoin, or we already have cryptocurrency, then why we need something like Ripple? Why can't we just say that we have exchanges, so whenever I want to transfer money, I can just take this, go to my local Bitcoin exchange, convert that to Bitcoin, then perform a Bitcoin transaction, and again convert that back to the other currency that I want to perform. Okay, so in principle, you can do that. And rather, what can happen with such a network is that it allows you to perform all these things just in one step. Okay, so that can be looked at as one application of here, such a like credit network-based payment system. That it allows you to have a more like a more distributed exchange for your currencies, which can flow across different currencies, across different continents, and also change the currency types from one to other, even including user-defined currencies. Okay, I also try to put these things on slightly more definitional perspective, and indeed, as you can see, cryptocurrencies is more like money. So, or I think maybe we can just call it is money. So the idea will be it's a medium of exchange. So every currency, in that sense, everything is equal to each other. I mean, every Bitcoin should be equal to each other. That's what we feel, at least. I mean, there are issues in that space, but in principle, they are equal to each other. So basically, you can look at as a cryptocurrency is like money, and the money or the cash is typically considered as a future product. So when somebody receives the cash, it's not only something which is available to them, but it's also available that anybody who owns that later. So it's a future productivity for the public in general, like with the cash. While the credit network, it's more similar to the credit system, where it is more like one can look at that as when somebody receives a credit, it's something that they receive. Okay? So there are exchanges that are possible with the money and credit, but conceptually, it's only the productivity or the availability that is available to the specific borrower. So as you can see here, in the cryptocurrency, one can easily see that anybody can transfer the bitcoins or all other currencies to anybody else, and the transactions are directly possible between any two wallets. However, in credit network, the key thing is that transaction only has to happen over the path. Okay? Otherwise, you just can't make a settlement which will be equivalent and which will maintain the correctness of the network. And that has an interesting effect in terms of, on the key property is fungibility. Okay? So I'm not going to say that the cryptocurrency is a perfect fungibility, but in principle they can. But it's just that, as we are seeing with the example, that people try to differentiate between is it a coins that are bad or whatsoever. So I'm just going to claim that they have good fungibility. However, in this case, it is restricted by the availability of path. What I mean by that, I'll make it clear with an example just on the next slide. Okay, and because of this, however, this restriction can bias good scalability, and that was one of the things that I like to show during our discussion today. So as you can see, the first thing that I like to discuss as something which I think is correct, so some people at times call credit network system more permission network. And I find it that to be not accurate. The key thing is that although you may have difficulty to obtain the links in the earlier part, but as itself, you can always introduce the new nodes and the new edges into system. So in that sense, it's not permission to the to make perfect sense. So I don't find that to be permission in that sense. So that's certainly one thing that I would like to mention. The another thing that will be interesting to discuss again as a comparison is this restricted fungibility. What I mean by that is that consider our user here. And let's say she has these two links with two different banks. Let's say on the Alice Bank and Dave Bank, okay? Now, she has $15 in this account. So one can also look at these as account. Like she has $15 in her account with this bank, Alice Bank, and $10 on her account with the Dave Bank. And here, she cannot transfer this money from the Alice Bank to the Dave Bank just through the network itself. Why? Because there is no link which goes from Alice to Dave. Okay? So to transfer this money, there should be some part of the network, or through some way, it should be possible to have some link which goes from Alice to Dave. Okay? So the transaction that I'm talking about is something which starts and ends at both at Alice. She just wants to say that, it's more like saying that you're transferring money from one bank account to other bank account. Okay? And for that to happen, even in the real world, your banks should communicate with each other. Okay? And that's how I'll put the restriction here, that similarly, in this case, only certain amount of transaction, only when the path is available, are possible. Otherwise, it can't be possible. Okay? So that's a kind of a restriction that comes in picture. However, I'm going to claim that maybe you do not need the whole property regarding the introducing proof of work in such a system. And we know that probably we know by now that we'll be spending, especially Bitcoin mining, we'll be spending enough power equal to the power that Denmark spent by the 2020. Okay, so if we define, and that will be the we are going to discuss later in the tutorial, that in distributed credit network, we may not require a global consensus. And that can have a significant effort in terms of reducing this cost that is required in terms of proof of work. But yeah, that we'll discuss more detailed in later. At least the current Ripple network doesn't follow this distributed premise to its perfection. All right, so what kind of state of art that we can see here? So similar to Ripple, there is also another system called Stellar, which is also present there at a lesser extent, but also followed. It's actually forked from Ripple, and they have several similarities, but not everything exactly the same. But among themselves, the Ripple is the one which is indeed used significantly more. Okay. For example, these are the latest number that I found yesterday about their daily trade volume, and mostly it's used for the remittance purposes, and also some banks. All, for example, the prominent transaction that happens today are in countries like between US, Canada, Germany, China, and Japan and Singapore are the main players, but they also are developing and introduce. They are getting nodes in different systems as we speak. And many of the banks like this system as the backbone for their transactions, so that they can perform those transactions much quicker than the way they are performing today, especially the transaction which goes across the borders. Okay, and that's the reason we are seeing a growing increase in the usage of such a system, mostly not in more P2P, peer-to-peer scenario or user-to-user scenario, but between bank-to-bank kind of a scenario. Okay, actually still in this whole Ripple concept is their consensus protocol. And what they use is that they use, it's wrong, it has issues at the two level. Is that they decide to go for the previous concept of having an agreement or a consensus protocol among well-known and well-defined entities, okay? And this consensus protocol is chosen, those parties are chosen by more like in company way, where they just try to, it's more like an invitation only. When you become highly active in such a network, you get invited that why don't you join our consensus process. And because of this lack of openness, it's a major criticism that Ripple is receives in academics and peer-to-peer currency community. Okay. Another thing is that they, instead of just using like PBFT or something like more standard things, they just decide to define their own non-standard atomic broadcast protocol. Okay. And its security is just unclear. I mean, it's not that well documented. It works. I'm not going to say that it's broken, but it can be improved at least, or maybe can be fixed also in some sense. But that is also an interesting problem to look into in general, because it's a system that is working today. But for our discussion today, we are just going to keep this consensus issue aside for now. We just focus on its applicability and the privacy issues more in general. Okay. So. One thing where the Ripple system is much closer to cryptocurrencies is that it came as a part of this whole blockchain or the cryptocurrency drive. So they maintain some properties, especially the transparency or the public verifiability of the transaction that they maintain. So similar to Bitcoin, the idea is that whatever is agreed upon consensus is posted on a ledger, and the ledger is again like attested append only logs. So everything just keeps on getting added to this ledger system, and it's available for anybody to view. Okay, and as we are going to see very soon, it has the same privacy problem as Bitcoin or such currencies see. I'm going to add that the problems are even more severe here, because in Bitcoin, you will always keep on changing to the new addresses. But in such a system, my node has value, and that value just does not change very quickly, right? I mean, I'm not going to have just lots of node, because then I'm not able to use them in a manner so that, let's say I perform one transaction with one node, another with other, and when I want to just combine those credit to perform third transaction, I can't do that, right? Because they are not connected or whatsoever. So indeed, the privacy problems become bigger, because you will be performing the transaction again and again with the same nodes or same IPs or same public keys in that sense, because node is again can be represented just as a public key hash. Okay, so as it turns out, all this transaction, everything is online, and again similar to the Bitcoin, the idea of your identifier is your public key hash. Okay, and that's you basically when you perform the transaction, you sign it with the providing signature using this public key, and that's the way you perform transactions. But again, all these details are online. I mean, you can just basically go through a transaction and find out all the transactions that have happened in such a system since the beginning. just similar to the standard Bitcoin blockchain, okay? And although it provides pseudonymity to the user, and actually, even on their system, they claim that they have some kind of a privacy, but I don't need to say to this crowd that indeed, pseudonymity can easily link to the linkability and eventually breaking the privacy. And this is certainly something which can happen here as well. So as it turns out, it's possible to link the multiple transaction and identity that belong to the same user. And that's what we are going to see. So the question is, is privacy a real issue in such a Ripple network? And we try to actually communicate on their forums. And initially, again, the response was that privacy is certainly something which is innocent or not, it's not breakable. And then you can prove that it can be broken. Okay, so as it turns out, we realized, given the initial tame response earlier, maybe the best way to do this is to break the privacy. And that's what we had a paper this year, and which led to a much bigger discussion on their forums regarding how the privacy issues are, which appeared in this year's PITS, and where we just try to, I'll not say we solve a lot, but we just try to show that, look, what kind of problems we can see in such a system. So to just to give you an idea, in this effort, we showed two heuristics, and I'm just going to give a brief overview about what kind of heuristics can happen here. And these heuristics, the idea is that they are slightly different, or they look different as compared to the standard Bitcoin heuristics that we've already seen. Okay, so the first heuristic has some relation with the other systems, such as Bitcoin. And the idea will be you may want to actually introduce currencies to your links in the system. So let's say we assume here our user Carol, and she wants to actually send money to and add the link into the Ripple network by actually putting money on those links. Okay, so what she can do is that she can communicate with this with more prominence in such a system, which are called gateway in Ripple. And she can give, let's say, Bitcoin to this dividend rippler. And then dividend rippler is supposed to create a link which goes from dividend rippler to Carol. And, Alice. So Alice. And include, let's say, the respective amount on that link which goes from him to, from dividend rippler to Alice. Okay? Now, the idea will be we are going to see such two transactions in such a log. And then can we employ this to actually link the identities or the accounts that Alice has in Bitcoin and in Ripple, okay? I mean, why not? We see the two transactions there on the log, and maybe you may try to do that. Not only that, we may be able to use that to link the accounts for the dividend rippler, that what is a dividend rippler's Bitcoin account and what is a dividend rippler's Ripple account, okay? So obviously, these things are possible, but you may say that maybe you still have to be synchronize the log in better way. As turns out, today, that's even very easy, as we're going to see. Because many of these gateways and exchanges, they again want to demonstrate their transparency, so they put all these logs online. Okay? So in principle, although we do not require, they basically just say that how people are exchanging on their system. So we can just take these three logs, okay, Bitcoin ledger, the other ledger, and this intermediate log in between, and just link all the transactions that are happening between the Bitcoin or most of these ledgers or most of these gateways and their users very easily and effectively. Okay, so this interlog linkability can easily be employed to actually connect the different accounts between different systems. And let's say now you know somebody in Bitcoin, you also know them in Ripple, or vice versa. Okay, so this can be certainly easily happen. And the second heuristic that we're going to see employs a concept called hot and cold wallet. I mean, it's also present somehow in Bitcoin, but it's just much prominent in such a system. Okay? So let's say we have somebody, and he has $100,000 with him. But as with our real life, he's not going to carry all this amount always with him. Okay? Instead, what he's going to do is that he's going to put this in his safe and only draw a small amount every now and then and perform the daily transaction. Let's say you go to a restaurant and paid $40, go to a movie, saw a movie, and maybe went to the bank and maybe perform a transaction which cost him $20. Okay, and maybe get the money from there as well. So the idea typically that we employ in real world is that we try to differentiate between our cold storage or cold wallet and a hot storage, which is something which we carry in our wallets, right? Similar thing is actually very useful and has been employed in systems such as in Ripple. So there, what happens is that there are most of the, especially the bigger nodes, they try to differentiate between such hot wallet and cold wallet. And then idea is that they will have these cold wallets which are connected to their users or whatsoever, but when they want to perform the transaction, they perform the transaction via hot wallet. And then idea is that with this, their cold wallets, people can't easily and quickly determine the IP addresses of their cold wallet, because as you can see, the cold wallets, once they get compromised, there is a significant credit or the value that is associated with them. But instead, they just use the hot wallet for more regular transactions, so that even when they get traced, they will only get traced to the hot wallet, and people may not immediately know the link between the physical location or the physical IP address of the cold wallet. Okay. And the idea will be every now and then, maybe regularly, every few days or when the need arrives, you're going to send money from your cold wallet to the hot wallet, and all the transactions they are then performed is from this hot wallet to the all other accounts. Okay. And the challenge that we like to solve is that I want to link the hot and the cold wallets of the users, okay, by given just the transaction log. And that's what we can try to do in such a system. So the idea will be, we'll try to look at, here I'm just giving a toy example, but obviously we have to go through the logs and try to look at the transaction volume and all different things. But the idea will be, we are going to try to find out the cold wallets. And cold wallets will be the wallets which are typically somebody who only give out credit. These are the nodes which are central, which will be more like a bank, and they will only owe others the money. Okay? Then with that, we are able to fix the cold wallet that we got. And then idea will be, now given such central node, we want to find out which among the other nodes are actually their own nodes and which are users of them. And as it turns out, the cold wallets only communicate with some nodes, very few nodes in the system, and not very frequently, but maybe after a certain amount of time when those nodes go low on the value, and they perform the transaction in such systems, which we can just easily characterize. And the hot wallet, on the other hand, perform the transaction which actually flows from them and go to the other users of the system. Let's say going from B to D, B to C, stuff like that. And our idea was to try to find out such patterns. Okay, there will be obviously noise, and there is a noise. But the idea is to be perform that level so that we can with high confidence say that what are the cold wallets and hot wallets in the system. So that based on such a communication pattern that can happen in such a system. Okay, so that's what the idea is, that looking at such a structure, now we can know that the accounts A and B belong to the same person, and looking at this log, we try to determine that. So what we do here is just, I would say, very basic info. Two measures that we are able to employ. Obviously, as the network goes, there will be much better and interesting patterns that we can find in such a system, and it will be a very interesting challenge to consider. Nevertheless, but whatever we did, we were able to significantly, we picked the bigger nodes in such a system, and these were the transaction volumes that was known already in such a system. But just with this very simple two measures, we are able to significantly improve the other transactions which were previously unknown for them. And we are also able to find out that some of these nodes are actually associated, or they are just the same. So they had three different cold wallets, but they were paying to the same hot wallet. And we found that, for example, the red one shows the unknown transactions. And especially for the things on the right-hand side, we were able to see that some of these guys are sharing a wallet, so maybe they all belong to the same owner. And as it turns out, it's indeed the same owner who own all those things, okay? We obviously tried to contact them. Some of them responded positively that indeed, yeah, these nodes belong to us. Some of them also just make them public afterwards, but not everybody. Some just decide to ignore our emails. At least we did not get any threat email saying they will sue us or something like that. But yeah, this just shows that these are the basic things which can employ, and in such a system, many more interesting heuristics can work out. And if you are somebody who likes to play with the data, I'll be more than happy to talk to you about that. All right, so now that we know the privacy is a problem, let me spend my remaining time try to talk about different privacy problems in such a system, or how can we move towards that. So as a research, the first thing that we like to do is that define what do you mean by privacy in such a system, okay? And this is the work that we perform in NDSS a couple of years earlier. And then idea is that to define privacy, we try to define that using breaking the properties with some basic properties, and then try to achieve them in a combined fashion, so that when you compose this property, you get the whole privacy as you would like to achieve there. And the two key properties that we define is the transaction value privacy and the receiver privacy. Okay. And so transaction value privacy says that, let's say an adversary who can see the whole network and the communication and the transition that are happening in such a network. And the only where the network differs is the place where a particular transaction performed, which was, let's say, for the $10 in one case and $30 in another case. And it should not be possible for adversary to distinguish between the one of the two scenarios. Okay? While in the receiver privacy, as you can see, I'm going to keep the transaction value the same and change instead the participants. I mean, receiver, I'm going to change the receiver. I can also respectively, correspondingly change the sender privacy, and where the sender is the party that should be hidden. And similar, we can define concepts in the same manner as well. Okay? And the idea is that we can compose these properties together to prove anything for the whole network. Let's say you want to actually hide the privacy of a link. Because the whole transaction, a whole network is made from the and using transactions, one can compose these properties towards obtaining that goal. Okay. As it turns out, the devil is always in the details. When we started to actually quantify this aim of doing so, we found out that there are very interesting challenges. So. The first thing is, let's try to define this system more in the way we will define our standard cryptographic protocols. So we'll have attacker and the challenger, and we'll assume that the whole network is made by attacker only. So he will keep on sending the links that he want to perform, the transactions or whatever he want to perform, and keep sending those to the challenger, and the challenger is the one who is going to keep on maintaining the network. Okay, so. And just perform when the transactions are successful, it will give him yes or no based on this communication, okay? And that's how it will form the whole network. Once the attacker is happy, then the challenge phase will come, okay? And what we'll allow now here is the challenges to make the two challenges to have, take two transactions, say that, the attacker to pick two transactions of his own choice and give those to the challenger. And then idea is that the challenger should just pick one of them uniformly at random and perform this transaction on the system. But as it turns out, to prove the security, we have to assume that attacker at least have some more uncertainty in the system. Okay, so it's very similar to the voting protocol. So those of you who have worked on voting, for voting to be secure or to prove the privacy, we have to assume there is a concept that we employ called balancing vote. Okay. So the idea will be, whenever you want to look at the whether the adversary should not determine what was my vote, you expect that when I voted, there was somebody else who also voted in approximately same time, so that an adversary who is looking at the log continuously can't determine whom I voted. Okay? So respectively, we also want the concept of balancing transaction here, where we'll assume that there will be another or one or more transactions that are happening in such a system which are not immediately visible to the adversary. And then ideally, this balancing transaction will be performed along with the chosen transaction. And basically, all these transactions, however, their presence will be still notified to the adversary. Okay? And then adversary can again keep on doing the querying for the whole system, and it should not still determine which transaction was chosen. Okay, so the balancing transaction from more realistic perspective, I mean, that's a game, but more realistic perspective, you can assume that in the network, there are transactions that are always happening. So even if adversary is after some particular node, we expect that there are other transactions which flow through the similar paths, or at least partially in through the same paths, which actually are not immediately available for adversary to see and determine. And we expect them to provide some privacy against an adversary who can otherwise see the whole network and see all the transactions that are performing. Okay? So like with the crypto protocol, we try to define something very strong for the privacy, but in the some sense, then we are able to characterize at least what kind of weaknesses in terms of this balancing transition we will require in such a system. We can define the receiver privacy also similarly using similar game and including similar transaction. And then our idea will be that we just define that it satisfies the value privacy if the challenge, the adversary picks 0 or 1, or it chooses that the challenging transaction for minus 30 has performed, independent of what is actually performed by the challenger, okay, the standard security way that the observations does not allow him to know more about the system. Okay, so this is the privacy properties that we like to achieve. Now, the question is that how can we achieve such a property? Okay, now we are looking at this problem. I mean, we already know it's an interesting system, but we are looking now that as the, from the first principle to begin with. Okay, what if I want to build such a system? Then the concept will be either I use decentralized network or the centralized architecture, okay? So in the centralized setting, if we assume that the whole network is maintained by a single server, okay? The problem is very challenging. The reason is that we can use extensions of private information retrieval to find out paths in such a system. So our task, key tasks are two, like find the path and then perform transaction on those path, okay? So finding the path problem can be solved because we can use something like some version of private information retrieval or extension of that to perform the whole path computation, okay? At least in principle, we can do that. However, if we actually perform the transaction on that network and in an adversary can see the whole system, that becomes a difficult problem, okay? We may try to use something much more complex to like PII writing, but it also depends upon security assumption that we like to employ in such a system, okay? So in our first paper, we tried to solve this problem, assuming that we can employ the trusted hardware scenarios there and the oblivious algorithms to solve it, okay? Later in the lecture, we're also going to look at the decentralized setting where maybe I think much more interesting and challenging problems are present to solve, at least for us, okay? So what we do is that we are in the centralized setting, so we assume that the network is maintained by the service provider, okay? And now, the idea is that we're going to assume that the service provider is honest but curious, like similar with the trusted hardware kind of a way of looking at honest but curious, okay? And some users can be also controlled by him, but we expect that the other users are the one who want to perform the transaction and still want to maintain the privacy in such a setting, okay? So in this setting, the service provider can trivially break the privacy. Again, similarly, as we mentioned, the routing operation can be performed privately, but the modification to the edges are difficult to hide from it, okay? So the idea is that maybe we can employ the trusted hardware scenario along with the oblivious computing here. So what we do here is that we assume that the web server side has a trusted hardware, okay, which maintains the whole credit network system for you, and the users communicate with this trusted hardware and perform the transaction over the credit network, okay? But we don't expect this credit network to be small, and even no matter if you go to SGX or whatsoever, the memory will be always the challenge, okay? So the correctness can be checked by the remote code attestation. However, to stop the adversary from leaking information by just observing how the data is maintained on the system, we employ the oblivious algorithms here. So the idea will be the users communicate with this trusted computing module to actually over the TLS links and perform the remote code attestation for the servers, communicate through the TLS links, and then they basically perform their queries, which are performed obliviously on the data that is stored in an encrypted form in the server environment, unprotected server environment, okay? So that's a kind of a high-level premise of what we try to do. But the one question that we have left aside for some time since our beginning discussion is the routing problem, okay? And we know that we need to perform max flow computation or some approximate version of that, okay? So max flow computation, it's reasonable, but as you can see, if my number of users are in 100,000 and the links are going even much more than that, this may not be scalable, okay? So the currently known, or maybe there can be also lower bound, which just shows that we cannot do much better than the quadratic or cubic in the number of nodes, or quadratic and multiplied with some factor in the number of edges. So there are restrictions in terms of the performing perfect max flow computation. But as it turns out, this routing is no different from the standard network routing that we perform for the internet communication, right? And there they don't try to compute max flow, they don't try to use such a system. instead versions of something similar to what is, for example, this old work from Paul Francis on the landmark routing, where the idea will be you will find out some nodes in the systems which are highly connected, okay, and you'll try to find your path through them. So obviously there will be some path will be lost, but you can still employ them to meaningfully perform the transaction, and that's what even we try to do here. Let me give the details very soon. So in such a network, which is called landmark routing, you are going to pick some nodes, a constant number of nodes, okay, most of the time, which are highly connected, and let's say you're going to form the BFS tree or any kind of spamming tree from them, starting from them, and bring such a system. Okay, going for the links going out as well as links coming in, whatsoever. And you can create this whole such system called landmark universe. And then idea is that whenever the two parties, Alice and Bob, they want to perform a transaction, they will try to find out in which all on all the landmarks where they are coinciding, where they are present together, okay? And basically then try to, once they find each other, then idea for them will be try to find out a path for that each of those landmark, okay? From going from these node until the landmark, which are basically root nodes. So they will just going to find those path and stitch those path to perform the transaction between them. If they have enough credit on these links, they'll try to perform the transaction. If not, they won't, okay? So that's certainly an approximation that is allowed, because there can be some direct paths which need to go through this landmark. So there can be some more optimization that can happen, but basic landmark system just employs such key landmark to perform the transaction across these landmarks. Okay, and that's the approach that we are going to perform. Now, as it turns out, in our case, there is a big trade-off. So we want to perform this BFS, and obviously, in our case, we are going to use oblivious algorithm. So we want oblivious version of BFS, okay? And that itself is, again, a big challenge. So what we did is that, indeed, we separate out the two tasks as if there will be one module which will take the network, and it will create the oblivious, perform the oblivious breadth-first search computation continuously on the selected landmark node and keep on creating a graph, okay? Another landmark universe for all these oblivious BFS. And once that happens, whenever a new transaction comes in, the idea will be you are going to search this transaction in the oblivious BFS system. And then when you want to execute the transaction, you will go to the other real network and try to perform the transaction there. Okay? So as you can see, these things are not synchronized. I'm just going to claim that one thing, just the BFS computation just happens at a slow pace, while the transactions can happen much quickly, because once you know the path, you have to just follow the path and change the links much quicker than actually performing the things in an oblivious manner for the breadth-first computation. So it may happen that sometime you are provided a path which are no longer valid, okay? And in that case, when you try to actually perform the transaction, it will fail on the real network. But that's fine. So we'll have some false negative, but that's fine. Okay? Maybe you wait for some more time, perform the transaction again, and you will be able to succeed. Okay? Because the BFS will catch up, or maybe you pick the new path and you are able to perform that well. And this is the approach that we decide to take, that given the complexity of this whole BFS computation, we'll try to separate out here the aspect regarding the BFS computation and actually transferring the path. Okay, so as I mentioned, these two modules are not synchronized at all. So what we did is that, again, the Ripple data is public, so why can't we just take this data and try to see how we do with this system for such a data for the knowledge that was available so far. Okay, so we took the data. This is kind of old. I think I probably missed the wrong thing. Okay. And as it turns out, we worked the both versions, the non-private version of such a system, as well as the private version, which is basically our prepay protocol. Okay, you can expect that the non-private version is like extremely fast. I mean, we are able to perform payments. All these times are in seconds, so we are able to perform payments like extremely fast. The payments on other side, also all these times are microseconds, sorry. Milliseconds. So the transactions were very fast. Change links can be happen. Oblivious BFS, the BFS when we perform in the non-private version, that was much faster. But when we perform obvious BFS, indeed, we were introducing a significant delay in the whole system. However, we just saw, at least in that time, these delays are okay, reasonable in terms of the Ripple was taking 5 seconds to confirm the transaction. So adding another 2 seconds is not a reasonable task. That's what we found. The BFS computation that we are performing were in background process. And this is basically, as I mentioned, this is only false negative. So as it turns out, when we perform the transaction, we are able to 97% of the time, we were able to perform that in just first go because the network was quite liquid. But even when the liquidity is slightly low, we run it again and we're successful to perform that. Okay, so all those things we were able to perform significantly. We also tried to actually talk with Ripple to see if they buy our solution for any reasonable purpose, but they were privacy at least until that point, or maybe now they are, after the PETS paper, they are getting more serious about it, but at least that time it was secondary concern for them. Okay, and trusted hardware is indeed something which we know can work for small systems maybe, but significant effort is required to build such a large-scale system using them yet, so more efforts are required. Probably with the SGX kind of technology, maybe something can happen. So basically, the Ripple was just not ready for this challenge. Okay, scalability will also be an issue once the number of nodes grow. BFS computation is again going to be much more bigger task. So we just found that to be much challenge. And the coverage may also drop because the BFS computations will take more time. So you may have really stale information into that system. So coverage may also drop down. Okay, so the question that we ask is that, can we find a solution that is compatible with the current Ripple network so that we can just include that in their system, in the current architecture, and try to solve the system? And we observe that maybe we can solve it, but with a small caveat. Okay, and the caveat is maybe we have to give up on some kind of a privacy, at least for now. So what we decide is that we're going to provide some maybe receiver privacy, okay, but we'll give up upon the value privacy. And then idea is that for those of you who know the Bitcoin system, there is a coin join transaction which can be employed to get the privacy so that you perform several transactions of the same value simultaneously. So why can't we do something like that here? Okay. So the idea is to perform several transactions simultaneously which are of the same value and which share some node in between which is common, and as they are for the same value, now you do not know which sender is talking to which receiver. Okay, so it's certainly an inferior property, but it certainly seems which it's possible with the network today. We just try to combine the transaction, like with the coin join. I mean, those of you who know coin join in Bitcoin, this is the relation over there. With small thing, however, that there is no coin join kind of a thing which was available in Ripple, so we also have to introduce that concept there. And that can have its own advantages where you want to, let's say, perform simultaneously several transactions. And we are able to actually just using standard cryptography like threshold signatures and the existing scheme, we are able to successfully include this protocol and also perform the transactions on current Ripple network, where their transaction, we can provide you a link where we are able to combine these credits and let them flow through each other. Just so that the users are, you can hide behind your anonymity set, which will be equal to the number of senders which are sending the same money along with you. Okay? So this was certainly something which is possible. All right. So it's still a weaker product, but very interesting. So more things can indeed happen here, and I'll be more than happy to talk about that. Now, let me use my last 10 minutes or something like that. Sorry, I'm holding you from the lunch because this is a slot I got. So for last 10 minutes, I'd like to actually talk about what if we don't want such system to be more centralized or the way they are currently with the Ripple. We want a distributed network. So the first thought is, and this is a work of ours which is going to appear in NDSS, we just heard back, so in 3 or 4 months. And the idea is that, let's say, what if rather than the whole global system maintaining the links, what if only local user maintain some local information only to them? Okay, so try to think that from more like how routers work today in the internet. Okay, they don't know the whole internet. What you know is only probably how to reach some nodes in some form. Okay, you have a routing table where you have partial information. So why can't we envision such a system here in this case where user only maintain their local links? Okay. For example, here, Alice, she'll only know this particular link, which is her only path to the network, that this is how I can reach somebody in the network. And so can Bob, he can just remember all those links. So what if you try to just only remember the local information? Okay, availability is certain something we are going to check or important, but let's say we are going to look at this from the security and privacy perspective, okay? What can be effect of that? What if this, how can you make sure that then you don't get cheated or the law, there are inconsistency in the credit networks, okay? So as it turns out, it's not a problem. I mean, basically the credit links of a user determine its credit path in the network, right? So the only links are, your links are what that matters. So let's consider our Bob over here, okay? He has inflow from a bank for $450 and outflow for $15 and $25 to some other friends of him, okay? So in principle, we can compute here the net flow there, okay? So it has inflow of 450 and outflow of 40, so its net flow is 110, okay? And for this Bob, when some transactions, he doesn't perform any transaction, he's just some intermediary. The key thing that we saw earlier that he can allow the transaction, let's say a transaction happened from Dave to the bank, okay? The transaction can go through and he'll not mind with this transaction as long as his net flow remains the same, okay? So I'm a user in system. I don't worry about any other transactions in the system. A, if I'm not involved in that transaction, if not, I'm not on the path, why should I care? Second is, even when I'm involved on the path, as long as my inflow and outflow remain the same, why should I care? Okay, so indeed, so a user who can just only remember the local information, it might be sufficient for him to ensure that there is nothing badness or no new rules or no money just created out of blue in such a system, okay? And that's what we try to employ into the distributed credit network structure, that I'll try to only remember maybe only one half information, okay? This can be improved to have more halves, but for our discussion, assume that it's just one half information. How can I employ that to do interesting things, okay? So we also have to deal with, again, the same problems, okay? Finding path, performing transition on that path, so that they actually succeed. And then ensure that the values are changed, and we also want like good privacy. We want to achieve all our the two value privacy and the transaction privacy. Okay, we also want to make sure that indeed the transaction can happen in such a system. It's not that they get lost. Okay, and maybe we also want another property, accountability, which means that I should be able to prove that look, this guy is not responding to my request or something like that. Okay. Yeah, so we'll try to just look at the basic overview, what we can try to do. So the one thing is we again try to go for a completely distributed system, but a decentralized system. But the challenge is that node may not be online, or the whole MPC in such a setting can become quite nightmarishly difficult, given that transaction should happen on the paths. Instead, we went for a simplifying aspect where we'll again use these landmarks. We'll assume that landmarks are the prominent nodes. And let's say they take availability, but let's say they take another node that they are going to perform multi-party computation, work as a computing party and perform multi-party computation for us, so that we can achieve the privacy property the way we want. So the idea will be users, they will actually get their links, and when a particular transaction to happen, they have to, the transaction, let's say on a one path, you have to compute the minimum on this particular path. So amount of value that can flow on this path will be equal to minimum, which is just 10. And they want to perform that privately, so they are going to perform private min computation. So every user is just going to take their link values and share them among these landmark nodes, okay? And idea is that as long as all the landmarks do not collude with each other, under that assumption, we know that they cannot determine my links value, okay? Another thing that I can do is that how you know that this, the value that, that I'm providing to you is a correct value, okay? The idea is that every link value is associated again with only two nodes. Only two nodes bother or care about that value, which is the two edges or the two nodes which are associated with that particular link. So what we can say that maybe the two nodes can add a proof that we both approve that the sharing is happening correctly. Okay, and they know this value, so there is no privacy among them because this is their value, their link value. So what we do there is that basically we assume that they have a signing and verification key pair, And they are going to sign or verify the shares that we generate for this secret sharing shares that are generated for these values on the path. Okay, such that now the signatures on the shares are provided along with the shares to the computing party so that they know that this is correct. Okay, and the correctness proof will be basically, you know that for a path, you should always, for on any given path, the for any link, the final node in that link, the public key should match it with the initial or the beginning node on the next key. So that's how you can say that the keys change, like VK remains in common there, and so there's VK3, VK4, and so on. So you know that except for the first and the last node, in all other cases, there should be a linkage that should form between all these signature key. But again, one more property that we like to protect is the freshness. It may be possible that somebody can know who is performing transaction by looking at these public keys. Okay, so in principle, the public keys that are employed in some system like Ripple, we don't need to stick to them here. Okay, for every new transaction, these guys can use the new public and private key pair, because again, the only thing that matters is the link to the two nodes. Okay, and they can pick and they can choose any combination for their keys. It can be also fresh key. Okay, so that's what happened here, and then the whole idea is that all the nodes such just keep on sending such signed shares to each other. Okay, and now the landmark perform the min computation on for all these values, and they obtain the minimum value and say that this is the value of the transaction that you can perform for going from, let's say, Alice to Dave. Okay, this is tell to them, and now they can decide whether it is sufficient for them to perform the transaction or not. And again, it's possible, like once it receives all the copies from all these nodes, with enough copies, Alice can compute the value that is required here. Okay. Now, once we know that this is sufficient, the idea will be you want to execute the transaction in such a system. Okay. So that now you know they have enough credit. Now you want to execute the transactions, and there the property that you want is that sometime maybe somebody just take the credit, but they don't pay to the next node. Okay, so you want a mechanism where so that you have a two-step transaction where everybody first keep a hold that, oh, I'm going to allow this transaction to happen, and later they release in an order such that it's always beneficial for them to remove the hold. So I first give money and then I take money from the guy before me. Okay, so basically this is, for those of you who know the payment channel, it's similar to that respect in some sense, where you basically have a cryptographic mechanism using commitment, which allows you to perform the transaction in a manner so that nobody can just cheat in between and obtain the money. So similarly here, we use the cryptographic commitment to actually hold the amount and then give it back. So for example, in a transaction like that, first there'll be hold that is placed by Alice on here that I'm going to pay $5, and that will be performed at the bank, and then it is performed on the other side with things. So the key challenge will be to keep these holds in a proper order, okay? So the details are in the paper, but for our high-level discussion, maybe just assuming that something like that is possible is sufficient, okay? And once the receiver receives, he's going to tell that, I received the amount, and things can be just worked out perfectly. All right, so this silent whisper work, it has a very interesting property. We allow the transaction to happen currently, but at a time only they are blocking. So only one transaction can happen at a given point of time. Okay, and interesting thing to see here is that given this whole distributed nature, we do not require any blockchain in that sense. Okay, or proof of work. More importantly, proof of work. Okay. Because as you can see here, the key question that may come is that some intermediate nodes may be offline. Now, what do you do? So in principle, it is possible that the nodes themselves not only just send these their link values only for the computation, but they are stored there when they go offline. And anyhow, you're trusting the landmarks to perform the computation correctly. You can also trust them to store the values. And when you come back again online, you again only have to check one thing. Is my net flow, which is basically inflow minus outflow, remains the same before I went to sleep and when I came back. That is just sufficient for me to be happy that, everything worked out correctly. And something like that can indeed happen, okay? And basically, the whole paper tries to actually build such system and try to test that with the existing network. And maybe there is a future to this whole distributed credit network, which can allow you to perform, settle the transactions without requiring more, most importantly, proof of work kind of a system. All right, so what are the interesting, I mean, there are, as you can see, you might have already started doing, there are like several interesting things that can happen from the security point of view, or even just the computing point of view. But there are also other systems, for example, payment channels on Bitcoin, such as Lightning Network and stuff, where the privacy is indeed weak as it is in current form, and so is the availability. And maybe what we've seen here, it can be interesting thing to define or design solutions in that space where we can employ some of these ideas there. I mean, there are also other solutions which are coming there, but defining privacy itself is still in an early phase there. So this can be something interesting where, if you're interested, I'll be more than happy to talk. Another thing that is maybe a bit more in future, but already happening, at least in other WC3 consortium, is that eventually all these ledgers, like you take Bitcoin ledger, Ripple ledger, or Ethereum ledger, all these ledgers, they will have to talk to each other. Okay? So people have started to think to have protocols which can allow the ledgers to talk to each other. And these whole systems called interledger communication. Okay? But as you can see, the interledger essentially will always have such path-based transition. There will be somebody who is present in the both ledgers and who is allowing the transactions. So he becomes some guide, intermediate guy on this path. So techniques that we are trying to study can be also helpful there. But still, it will come up with its own interesting challenges that has to be worked out. All right, so that's like basic in some of the interesting things. So I like to, I'm coming to the end of my discussion so far. And I like to thank my collaborators from mostly from Saarbrücken in Saarland University in MPI and in Purdue. And I thank them. I mean, most of the interesting thing is done as their thesis work or just as a collaboration that we are doing. And obviously, I'm here. The reason I decided to give this highly overview kind of a system and credit to get more people excited in this system so that we can work on interesting problem. And their hope is to make the credit networks great again. Okay, so that's it. Thanks a lot from my side. So just these are the take home four slides, which just says why this is interesting, what are the real privacy challenges, what can we do, and what can be the interesting protocols. But yeah, I'll be more than happy to have questions now. Are there questions? Seems like that people are very happy with, very happy to go on lunch. But yeah, I'll be available if you have anything to ask later as well in person. Okay, thank you.